book of James chapter 4 go this morning as far as our lesson is concerned. James has been referred to as the most practical book in the Bible as far as the things contained in the book of James and for everyday living and Christian life there. And in chapter 4, he gives us some things that will help us to be able to resist the devil here. And this morning, we want to look at five of those things that will help us in resisting the devil. And of course, we know that the devil is one who is searching high and low, to and from, on the face of the earth to try to deceive people into believing the lies that he has to say there. The book of James implies that the devil assails God's people there. And the devil does attack us from time to time. God allows such as far as the Christian is concerned there. And he allows the devil to try us from time to time to see if we are as we should. And the book of James chapter 1 verse 12, blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. And let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. And so we see that there is a purpose, there is a reason behind the temptations that come our way, and that is that either so that we can determine our character as Christians per se. If we never had any temptations or trials, then we would never know exactly where we stand as far as our Christianity is concerned. That's why we have these trials and tribulations there. But James also gives some further insights as far as the devil is concerned and how that we can resist the devil, how we can overcome the devil here. Of course, the Bible tells us that Satan is one of the names that we use for the term devil, which means adversary there. And 1 Peter 5, verse 8 says that he is walking about seeking whom he may devour there. We also have the term devil, as I've been using there, which means slanderer there. And, of course, the devil is the father of all liars, and he always wants to try to deceive people. In Matthew chapter 4 and verse 3, he's identified as the tempter. The Bible says that the tempter came and tempted Jesus there, being the devil. Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 4 calls him the god of this world there. And so Satan attempts to deceive, to seduce, and destroy the people of God. Now, that's his purpose and that is his aim in life. And so the question is, what is it that we as Christians can do that will help us be able to resist the devil? Now, we know that a study of God's word is important as far as resisting the devil and resisting temptation that comes our way. But I want to submit four things to you that James gives us that will help us as far as our resisting Satan is concerned. He says, first of all, in verse 7, submit yourselves, therefore, to God. There's number one. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Now, the question comes, what does he mean when he says, submit yourselves unto God? Submission to God means and demands that one submit to God's righteousness. In other words, what God has given us to follow and to do. I think the book of Romans chapter 10, there, verses 1 through 3 gives us a good example of what we're talking about. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved, for I bear them record they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they being ignorant of God's righteousness, what is God's righteousness? The way we live our lives and what God demands of us as Christians. Going about to establish their own righteousness, this is what we have to be careful of, that we establish a standard that God has not established. So many times we can establish a standard and we say, well, I'm as good as old so-and-so. But the problem is we're comparing ourselves with the wrong one. We're not comparing ourselves to apples, or oranges to oranges. We're comparing ourselves apples to oranges rather than apples to apples and oranges to oranges. We need to compare ourselves to Jesus Christ and don't take upon ourselves that we are doing what God would have us to do, but yet we're not submitting to his will, basically. He says they're going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. Now, this has reference to the fact that the Jews were not doing what they should do. Rather, they were doing what they wanted to do and what they believed was right, and that's what we have to be careful of as Christians, to think that we are right when in reality we're not right. We have to be right in the sight of God. Therefore, we must be about doing God's righteousness, per se. God's plan for making man righteous is revealed in the gospel of Jesus Christ. In the book of Romans, chapter 1 and verse 16, the apostle Paul, in writing to the brethren there, says, "For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ." Now, there's where God's righteousness is. Where? In the gospel. It is not in the books that man have written. It is in the gospel. It is the gospel that will save us. "For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God." Where is the righteousness of God found? It's found in the gospel. And so if I do what the gospel says, I align my life and submit my will to God and his righteousness, then most assuredly I can be able to resist temptation when it comes our way. God's children must maintain a spirit of submission and obedience. Submission and obedience. It's important that we obey God, not just part. You know, we can do part of what God says and still be wrong. We've got to do the whole will of God. It's not enough to do part. We have to do it all there. So we have to be very careful that we make sure that we have that spirit of submission, and we'll talk more about that a little later on in one of our points that we have. The fact is, we as Christians must indeed be children of obedience. Look, if you would, in the book of 1 Peter, chapter 1, and verse 14, it says, "As obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lust in your ignorance." We have to be careful that we don't go back into the world. We don't take on some worldly ideas. We have to be according to God's will there. As obedient children unto his will there. The Spirit is going to be reflected in the way God's people respect God's word. You know, God's word is important, and how we view God's word is most important as far as our lives are concerned, because that's where we find the righteousness of God. Ecclesiastes 12, 13 and 14, we know that we have to give an answer one day there of the things we've done, and we will. The willingness to obey the Lord, to do what God demands, will enable the Christian to withstand Satan. That is, the willingness to obey. How willing are you to obey what the Lord has to say? Are you willing to do it in some things and not in others? Well, you have to do it in all. Not enough to do it in all of them, but one or two. We have to do what God would have us to do in all. So we must submit ourselves to God. The only way that we can resist the devil, and the only way that we can overcome the devil, if we submit to God. God is our defense against Satan. And if we want to overcome the evil one, if we want to overcome the slanderer, the tempter, the god of this world, then it's going to be because we submit to God and to his will in everything. Second of all, one must stay close to God. James chapter 4, look at verse 8 when he says there, "Draw nigh to God." That is to live close to God. What an honor. What a privilege it is to be able to draw nigh unto God. Not everyone can do that. Not everyone in the world that is religious can draw nigh unto God. Only those who are faithful, righteous children of God can draw nigh unto God. We have to be righteous people. God does not hear the prayers of the sinners. Therefore, it is a privilege as a Christian to be called a son or a daughter of God. What an honor we have. Now, you remember under the Mosaic system, under the law of Moses, only the priest could come near to God. Only the priest. And the people would come to the priest, who in turn would intervene on their behalf. That was the only way it was done under the old law. A person couldn't draw nigh to God per se. But under the new law, the new covenant, man can draw nigh unto God. Look with me, if you would, the book of Hebrews chapter 7, and look at verse 19. Hebrews 7, 19, 19. He says, "For the law made nothing perfect, but the bringing in of a better hope did, by the which we draw nigh unto God." Under the New Testament, each and every one who is a Christian is a priest of God. Therefore, the Old Testament, the priest could draw nigh unto God, but not the people. Under the New Testament, we as Christians today can draw nigh unto God if we so choose. Now, how sad it is that some people do not wish to draw nigh unto God. What they can get in Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night at church is all they want. They don't want to be any nearer to God than that, because it would involve too much on their behalf, their part, to have to study, to have to do whatever needs to be done to get closer to God. And so many times we do not have the desire to do that. Christians have access to the Father. We have access to the Son. We have access to the Holy Spirit. The question is, do we take hold of the access that we have? The way that we can access God, of course, is through prayer. Prayer is the only avenue we have to be able to talk to our Father in heaven. Do we pray as we ought? If we want to be able to resist the devil, we have to learn to talk to God. We have to learn to speak to Him about problems and trials we have in life. You know, the good thing would be that if we would speak to Him in the good times, it wouldn't be as difficult to speak to Him in the bad times. But a lot of times we don't speak to God in prayer until something bad happens, and all of a sudden we expect God to hear us right then and right now. And yet we've never approached Him before because of the good things. We never thank God for the good things. We just expect Him to be there when we need Him, when bad things happen to us. The Christian stays close to God in prayer there. Not only that, the Christian stays near God by constantly looking into the perfect law of liberty. In James chapter 1, verses 22 through 25, he talks about this perfect law of liberty there. And we have to observe what we see. "But be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. If we are hearers and not doers, we deceive ourselves." A lot of times we talk about it and don't do anything about it. "For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's likened to a man beholding his natural face in the glass. For he beholds himself, goes his way, and straightway forgets what manner of man he was." It's kind of like what I tell you many a time. Many times you get up in the mornings, you go into the bathroom, you wash your face, you look at yourself in the mirror. But you don't look at yourself in the mirror. You see, but you don't see. It's kind of like what Jesus said when it comes to the Word of God. "Seeing they see not, hearing they hear not, neither do they comprehend, neither do they understand." And so sometimes we walk in, look at the mirror, but we see, but we don't see. We don't take the time to look at ourselves face to face in the mirror. Women do, men don't. But the fact still remains, we don't look as close as we should. James is warning against that. "For he beholdeth himself, goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whosoever looketh into the perfect law of liberty, and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed." And so if I want to be closer to God, then I must do it by looking into the perfect law of liberty. That is this word that we have before us. We must study as we ought, that we can become closer to God. Now, so submit yourselves to God. Stay close to God. Basically, that's pretty close to the same thing. Now, third of all, is kind of close to even that. Look, if you would, here in verse 8 again, James chapter 4 and verse 8, he gives us another thing that we can do. He says, "Draw nigh to God, he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners. Purify your hearts, ye double-minded." Now, what in the world is James talking about here? He's telling us what? That singleness of mind provides one with the direction of life which enables him to withstand the devil. Singleness of mind there. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. We first of all have to take care of our lives, set them in order, in order that we can resist the devil. Friends, listen, if your life is not in order, if you're not ready to meet your Maker, do you think you're ready to meet Satan? I don't think so. As a matter of fact, if you can't meet Satan, you sure won't be able to meet the Lord come the judgment day. He says, cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. That word double-minded literally means two-minded. You got people that's two-minded in the church. You've got people that want to be a part of the world, and at the same time, they want to be a Christian. You cannot do that. That's double-minded. You cannot be a part of the world at the same time be a part of the Lord's church, because the church demands that you get the world out of your life. That's what we have to do. And so if we have and want to be a part of the world at the same time, want to be a part of the Christian life, God says it's not going to happen. James says you got to get rid of being double-minded. Matter of fact, this term double-minded is only used twice, and it's used both times in the book of James. Take your Bibles and turn back to James chapter 1 and verse 8. James says a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. Listen to that. A double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. The double-minded man wants to be a part of the world, and at the same time, he wants to do what's right as a Christian. And this is the battle our teenagers fight so often. They want to be popular, and what the problem is, a lot of parents want their kids to be popular, and that's a no-no right there, because you're forcing something on your children that they don't need. God says you don't need the world. You don't need the things of the world. As Christians, we're forbidden to be a part of the world, per se, and doing the things that the world does, and trying to live the Christian life at the same time. That's why our teenagers are torn, our young people are torn, adults are torn, because they want to be part of the world, and yet at the same time, they want to be a part of the church, and they can't be a part of the church because they're a part of the world. Now, what did John say in 1 John chapter 2, 15 and 16? We're to get rid of the world. Lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, the pride of life, none of that can be a part of us if we want to be a part of God. Now, he says, you got to get rid of this double-mindedness. So, what are we to do? We're not to be double-minded, we are to be single-minded. That's why we said the singleness of mind provides one the protection. The old song asked a pertinent question, is thy heart right with God? It do us all good to think about that from time to time. Is our heart right with God? The book of 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 13, Peter says, wherefore gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. See, Peter admonishes Christians to gird up the loins of their mind. Now, what does he mean? Well, it's a figure here. Gathering up the long flowing garments by means of a belt or girdle, so work or travel would not be hindered. Therefore, as far as what Peter is saying to us is, the mind should be set on the revelation of Christ and the grace that is brought into one's life. That's where we need to focus. We need to focus upon godliness. Godliness is great gain. Each and every one of us can focus upon God if we so choose to do so. Paul said in Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 and 2, set your affections on things above, not on things of the earth. You see, as Christians, our focus needs to be single-mindedness. Our only focus is upon things above, not on things of this earth. We need to be single-minded, that everything we do, everything we say as a Christian is focused upon heaven and my ability to get there, and the things that I do If I stay single-minded, focused upon God, I can get there. Otherwise, if I go double-minded, forget it. It's not going to happen. Can't be double-minded. I have to be single-minded in order to perform what God would have us to do. And not only that, so that I can resist Satan. Take your Bible and turn to Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2, the day of Pentecost, Peter had preached the gospel sermon there. 3,000 souls obeyed the gospel there. Verse 46, and they, continuing daily with one accord in the temple, the breaking of bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and what? Singleness of heart. They were focused on one thing and one thing only, and that was the gospel of Jesus Christ. That which God would have them to do, spiritual matters, spiritual things. They weren't concerned about the worldly things per se. They were focused. They had singleness of heart there in the early church. A fourth thing that we must think about as far as being able to resist the devil is we find here also in James chapter 4 and verse 9 is the fact that one must be constantly sensitive to sin in his or her life. Must constantly be sensitive to sin. Notice verse 9. Be afflicted and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning, your joy to heaviness. What's he talking about? Because of sin. You know, some people don't think nothing about sin. They can do it, doesn't seem to bother them. They become hardened. Their hearts become hardened. The Bible even speaks of such, to where that the word of God does no longer touch their hearts as it used to, and they become hardened. Be afflicted and mourn. Weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning. Why? Because of your sin. You must be sensitive to sin, because if you're not sensitive to sin, sin may rule you rather than you ruling it. You have to be sensitive to it. And that's what James tells them. Be afflicted and mourn. He's talking about mourning and weeping over sin. He's not talking about mourning and weeping over the dead. Although we are dead, if we're in sin, we're dead. We can become free from sin. We can become dead to sin. The choice is ours there. And James reminds us that unless one is conscious of sin in his life, he will not follow God's instructions for righteousness. You see, your conscience becomes seared. You don't focus anymore upon what you do and what you say and the things of life. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians 7:10, godly sorrow leads one to repentance. Didn't say godly sorrow was repentance, though. Godly sorrow leads one to repentance. One can have godly sorrow and still not repent. But if he has the godly sorrow that he ought to have, it will lead him to repentance there. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 4, Jesus promised to comfort those who mourned. And that blessing there is given to those who mourned over their sins. He's not talking about those who are mourning over the loss of loved ones. He's talking about the mourning over their own sins. Can we mourn over our own sin? Do we see the need to do something about our sin when it happens? If we're not sensitive to sin, if we don't pay attention to sin, then we're more likely not to do anything about our sins, aren't we? The world laughs at sin. It minimizes the tragedy of sin. How sad it is that sin today seems to be a common thing. I mean, there are certain things. We have so much lying going on in the world today. If you read in your paper today about the fake news about the mayor of the city of Tupelo having been arrested, didn't matter whether it's true or not. It was there. It was presented. It doesn't matter what is presented in Washington, true or not. Just so long as someone makes a statement, one is guilty till proven innocent. It seems that's the way the world's turned to. And we are not very sensitive to sin anymore. Our young people are growing up in a world today in which sin is laughed at, as I've already said here, is laughed at, it's minimized. You can tell a white lie, just don't tell a big black lie. And so we don't think much about it. We just see it as, well, that's just society. Well, it's sin. It's a sinful society is what it is, and we need to realize it. And then finally, humility is a resource which enables one to resist. Humility. Now, what do we mean by humility? Notice what he said in verse 10 of James 4. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. Humility is the opposite of what? Pride. Pride. Look who I am. Look what I've done. That's pride speaking to us. Humility is just the opposite of that. Pride eventually led to the fall of the devil. 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 6. The devil fell from heaven because of his pride. Pride stands in the way of many a man, many a woman, many a person from making it to heaven because they do not humble themselves in the sight of God, admit their guilt, admit their sin, and they act as though, well, I'm no different than anyone else. Pride stands in our way. Pride leads one to assume that he doesn't need God. I don't know what I need God for. Pride will cause one to do such as that. We all have a need for God. Matter of fact, that's why God wants us to pray. God wants us to pray to humble ourselves. He wants us to ask. Ask. He wants us to ask him to humble ourselves. A lot of people don't pray because they have too much pride. Too much pride. They have everything in life. They don't have a need for God. People who are rich don't have a need for God. Why do you think? Who do you think received the Lord's word graciously? The poor people. Why? They had a need. They had a need for God. A rich person doesn't have a need for God. He's self-made, he thinks. Look what I've done. Well, he hadn't done anything, really. He just happened to be at the right place at the right time. We allow pride to stand in our way, and it leads us to think that we have no need for God. I want you to look at Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, we're going to begin with verse 20. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things which are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because that, when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and in their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the corruptible God into an image made like a corruptible man, to birds, to four-footed beasts, and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness for the lust of their own heart, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, who worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them into vile affections, for even their women did change the natural use into that which was against nature, and likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in the lust one for another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was met. You see, pride can lead us to the point to where we don't need God. We're too proud. I don't need God for anything. Well, we see that because when they knew God, they glorified him not as God. You see what happened to the Gentiles, don't you? The Gentiles failed. God gave them up because he had no choice. We get so far steeped in sin, God's going to give us up as a people, as a nation, as a whole there. One must be humble and dependent as a little child. Now, we all know how children are. Children are very forgiving, are they not? I mean, one minute they'll be fighting with each other, pulling at a toy. That's mine. I want it. You can't have it. And the next minute they're there just hugging on one another, loving on one another. That's the heart of a child. And for God, not only knows we wish that we as adults could keep the same heart. We know that doesn't work, though. For some reason, we become hard-hearted when we get older. We can't forgive our brothers and sisters in Christ, and we just we have a hard time with that. But humility, we have to be humble as children. The realization that one is always in the sight of the Lord should keep one humble. James chapter 4 and verse 10, God knows all, He sees all, He observes all. You would think that would keep us humble. And God knows the things we do in the deepest, darkest, secret places that we have. God sees all, He knows all. He knows what's said, He knows what's not said. And people need to understand that one day we have to stand before God. We have to give an account for the things that we have said, the things that we have done, the life that we have lived here upon this earth. And it's not going to change simply because we don't think it's going to happen. Don't let your pride stand in your way of doing what's right, doing what God would have us to do. The weakness of man when contrast to the mighty hand of God, 1 Peter 5 and verse 6, should keep us humble. God not only knows everything and sees everything, God is in control of everything. I know a lot of people don't believe God's in control, but God is in control. He works in our lives today and in nations just as He did in the very Old Testament. He just doesn't do it in the way He did it, performing miracles and things like that He did in the past. But God still works by His providence in our lives and in the nations as well of the earth. Genuine humility causes one to realize his acute need of God. We're all in need of God. No matter who we are, we need God. How do we overcome the devil? How do we resist? Well, James gives us five good reasons that we can do that. Humility is a resource which will enable us to resist the devil. One must constantly be sensitive of their sin in their lives that they might have. Singleness of mind, that is, not being double-minded, having one thing, one thought, and all you're concerned with is living the Christian life. The fact that one must stay close to God and the fact that one needs to submit himself to God are things that can help us to resist the devil. Otherwise, we're one of his servants. And it's that simple. Either we're with God or we're against him. You can tell you what you want to and reason how you want to, but if we're not with him, we're against him. And so we need to think about how can we resist the devil. Well, James gives us some good pointers, brethren. We can overcome if we focus in the right direction and keep our focus there at all times. If you're here this morning, not a member of the Lord's church, becoming a child of God would be the most important thing, the greatest decision that one can make in life. Hear the word, believe it, repent of your sins, confess the good name, be baptized for the remission of sins. If you are a Christian and yet you've gone astray, you have the opportunity to repent and turn from the error of the way. And we encourage you to do that.